not Lord it over those assigned to him, but to be examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd is revealed, you will receive the unfading crown of glory. Word of the Lord. It has somehow found its way to freedom. mysteriously to him appear and disappear. We all know a bird is not created to fly inside a building. Nevertheless, we enjoy this brief visit. Life is like that. Life is like that. We are created by loving God and born one day. We spend a limited number of days on this earth enjoying life and enjoying each other and loving each other. For we are created for so much more, so much more. We are created to live forever with an infinite loving God. Our days on earth are brief. They're spent preparing for eternity by loving God and loving and serving our fellow human beings. Then one day, we're called to this earth to return home to our loving God forever. Bishop Joseph N was born in 1937 and remained a priest in 1963. Most of his priestly ministry was spent in Houma and Thibodaux, Louisiana. He was appointed bishop of the Diocese of Jackson in 2003. Now, I had the privilege of working with Bishop Latino for 9 years as Vicar General. I also had the great privilege of enjoying his friendship for many more years. He was a humble, gentle, and kind bishop. He chose as his episcopal motto that all may be one. The motto comes from the gospel passage which we have just proclaimed. In that gospel, Jesus is saying and praying for his disciples. But he also goes on to pray and say, for those who will believe in me through their word, that they may all be one as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they may also be in us. Jesus' prayer is that through the proclaiming of the gospel, we may all share together the life of God as one. That was the motto and the focus of Bishop Latino's Episcopal ministry. He wanted all of us to be one in Christ Jesus, and he promoted that unity in Christ. During his years as bishop, he proclaimed and spread the gospel in many ways. He promoted the ministry and helped establish programs to educate and prepare lay persons for ministry in the church. He appointed many lay priesthood ministers to oversee parishes and missions that did not have a full-time pastor. Promoted religious vocations. We instituted the formation program for the permanent diaconate. And during his tenure, several men were ordained to the priesthood for the diocese. He also welcomed international priests to proclaim the gospel and help serve parishes in the diocese that otherwise might not have a priest. During his office, during his tenure, the Office of Protection of Children was established to help ensure a safe environment for children, vulnerable adults, in churches, schools, and communities. And as bishop, he promoted gospel-based social justice. He publicly addressed such issues as racism, the rights of immigrants, care for the poor, death penalty, and the rights of life of the unborn. The Diocese of Jackson was blessed by the ministry of Bishop Latino. He's a gentle and humble shepherd who loved us. He lived up to his motto, proclaiming and spreading the gospel so that we might all live and be as one in Christ Jesus. We're thankful for the gift of his ministry, his leadership, and his invention. We thank the Lord for the years we enjoyed his loving service as our shepherd. But like the word in the seminary chapel, he was created for so much more, so much more. So we commend him to be good shepherd, the chief shepherd, Jesus Christ. And may Jesus Christ welcome him and say, well done, good and faithful servant. Welcome home to the place prepared for you for all eternity. Welcome to your true and eternal home. Amen.
president of the Catholic Foundation of the Diocese of Jackson, a position I hold to this day. I stand before you this evening, honored and humbled to represent the laity of our diocese. And I know there are many people across this diocese who would love the opportunity to deliver a testimonial about this great man. But while there are many more deserving, there are none more thankful. So to Bishop Copaz and Mary Woodward, thank you for this opportunity to share a few thoughts about a bishop and a person that I grew to love over the past 19 years. As many of you know, my wife Madeline and I are of Lebanese descent. And as Lebanese Catholic Christians, the forerunner of our faith is the Maronite rite, which was founded by St. Maroon in the 4th century in what was known as Syria Prima, which is now modern-day Lebanon. Today, the Maronite rite is, of course, in full communion with the Holy See and the Roman Catholic Church. Now, one of the precepts of the Maronite rite is that all ordained clergy are held in very high esteem by the congregation, so much so that they are always welcome into their homes, just as you would welcome any family member. My parents, Joe and Adele Rice, were the personification of this precept as they entertained bishops and priests across the diocese from the 1940s through the 1980s. My mother cooked Lebanese delicacies for every bishop, from Bishop Giroux to Bishop Latino, and continued, and Madeline has continued the tradition by entertaining Bishop Copaz. During the apex of those years, Bishop Bernini was a regular guest at my mom's Sunday lunch, enjoying baked and raw kidney, mishy, stuffed grape leaves, stuffed cabbages, meat pies, unleavened bread, which we now call pita bread, and an occasional highball. My father passed from this life to the next in 1993, and Bishop Bernini in 1996, almost to the very day. My mom continued to treat Bishop Howe occasionally, delivering to his home, but this entire endeavor took on a totally different dynamic when Bishop Latino came here in 2003. Maybe it was their shared Mediterranean upbringing, but they bonded on several levels, not the least of which was a spiritual level. Bishop Latino, for his part, understood fully the painstaking steps that went into preparing these Lebanese dishes. He often said that these dishes were prepared with great love and care, and he genuinely appreciated the effort and love that went into their preparation. My mother, for her part, enjoyed preparing these dishes and found great joy and fulfillment in using the gifts with which God had blessed her to enrich the lives of others, especially someone who appreciated it so much as Bishop Latino did. But more than that, I think they saw our Lord and felt the presence of the Holy Spirit in each other. And that is, after all, the true essence of friendship. In later years, Bishop Latino honored our family by delivering a moving and wonderful invocation at my mom's 100th birthday party. It set the tone for an absolutely amazing day. And just 3 years ago, Bishop Latino and Mary prayed the rosary with our family before her visitation and funeral at the age of 104. And today, I am convinced that they are partaking of the heavenly banquet where the kidney and the mission are prepared about how that particular conversation transpired, but in order for you to fully appreciate it, I must give you a little background about our foundation. And I guess the best way to describe it is to tell you that our foundation functions very much like the Pittsburgh Steelers. That's right, Pittsburgh Steelers, winners of 6 Super Bowls. You see, the Pittsburgh Steelers have had 3 coaches in the past 50 years. Our Catholic Foundation has had 2 presidents over the past 29 years. Chuck Adams for 21 years, and yours truly for the past 8 years. Now, the Foundation experienced unprecedented growth during Chuck's tenure, and to say his shoes were big, shoes to fill is a gross understatement. So when Bishop Latino contacted me about succeeding Chuck, I said, Your Excellency, I am honored and humbled, and I will do my very best, but I must tell you, I'm not as smart as Chuck Adams. What he said in reply was interesting. What he meant to say was, a lot of people are not as smart as Chuck Adams. But what he said was, don't worry about it, Joe. You're not as smart as a lot of people. Which may not be totally that. But after a quick realization of his faux pas and a good chuckle for both of us, he became serious. He said, Joe, I have observed your work and commitment over the years, and I know you're the man for the job. Then he said something that gave great insight into his leadership style and his core beliefs. He said, don't do it for me. Don't do it for yourself. Do it to and for the glory of God. That tells you all you need to know about Joe Latino, the bishop, and Joe Latino, the child of God. He observed and delegated authority when he saw the opportunity. Matching talent with objectives. A prime example is this magnificent renovated cathedral that will always be one of his lasting legacies. He decided to move ahead with the project, even though we didn't have the resources at the time to grab it on. But he knew he had the right man in place as rector of the cathedral, and Father Jeffrey Walker. He said to me later, after the project was complete, I knew Jeffrey could get the job done, and I was hopeful and prayerful that our Lord would provide. And praise be to God, he was right on both counts. We all saw and appreciated his sweet and loving and gentle personality, but he could be tough when the situation dictated. He understood that as shepherd of his flock, he would, from time to time, have to make the hard and unpopular decision. He never shrank from that responsibility, and garnered very much respect throughout the diocese as a result. You see, Bishop Joseph Latino was a strong leader. Bishop Latino was a courageous leader, but most importantly, Bishop Latino was a servant leader. He led and served our diocese with great distinction, and all the while and through it all, he provided a loving heart, a steady hand to his flock. God bless you, Your Excellency. Please pray for us, your flock, from your high place in heaven. Thank you.
left the seminary at the age of 14. I can install any facts to you about the bishop's life, but nothing that you can't find on Wikipedia. I think what he will enjoy tonight is if I share three stories with you. And I'll start off, one of the stories is a humorous one. The other, the second, is more of a mystery that I'll share with you. And then the last is more of a theological matter that involves some spiritual and even philosophical elements. In the first story I'd like to share with you, the title would be The Tale of the Black and Meatball. My earliest remembrance of Uncle Joe was at the age of 5. He had been a priest for approximately 2 years. It was Easter Sunday, and the family was getting together at my grandparents' home, John Peter Latino, Theresa Rizzuto Latino. Knowing our heritage, it shouldn't surprise you that meatballs and spaghetti were on the menu that day. And this was a big deal, especially being Easter. My Aunt Laura, a key player in this story, and my mother were feverishly assisting my grandmother in preparing the new meal. Uncle Joe had just arrived, and I, with my two older brothers, John and Tony, ran to greet him very enthusiastically. After much ado, Father Joe decided he needed to freshen up before dinner, and so he proceeded to go to his old room and enter the restroom to wash his face and hands. My older brothers and I tagged along, as usual. As we were standing in the doorway to the bathroom, Joe asked, "What's cooking?" To which my oldest brother John proudly responded, "Spaghetti and meatballs." Uncle Joe's response was somewhat lukewarm. He then inquired, "Who's making the meatballs?" John again responded, "I think it's Aunt Laura." Uncle Joe then responded, "Uh-oh." Now, before I finish this story, apologies to my aunt, who was a wonderful, wonderful chef, and all this was just a joke. However, keep in mind, I was 5 at the time. He followed with the previous experience he had with Aunt Laura's meatballs, claiming he had nearly blinded himself when they attempted to eat her meatballs. Jokingly, he began to elaborate on how he had unsuccessfully cut the meatball with his fork and had actually only succeeded in chasing it off his plate and onto the table. This is a visual joke, so I have a drop here. Finding himself frustrated, he said, he decided instead to pick up the meatball with his hand, forgetting that he had a fork in that hand, and as he raised the meatball to his mouth, he nearly took out an eye. I think my authority has called this story. At that moment, we called the dinner. My brothers, being ages 8 and 7, and having a slightly more sophisticated sense of humor, but I, being 5, had not fully understood that Uncle Joe was poking fun at his younger sister, who was in nursing school at the time. At dinner, the platter of meatballs came around, however, I passed. The second story, a little more serious. On August 28, 2005, and I should receive my story here with I'm a retired firefighter from the Manville Fire Department in Louisiana, who retired last year. On August 28, 2005, the Manville Fire Department was mobilized for a disaster relief that was caused by Hurricane Katrina. All three ships were called in on an indefinite deployment. We were relocated from the fire stations in the low-lying areas of Manville and placed at the Farm Group High School in the Interstate 12. The high school became the home of not only fire department, but also sheriff's office personnel, energy linemen from CLECO, and ATF agents. Each day was spent working to clear roads and highways to reestablish services for the area. These were 14 to 15 hour work days, using whatever resources especially. I couldn't believe it. And I actually thought that I might have been dreaming. And as he started to speak to me, I knew I wasn't dreaming. I said, how did you get me in this number? None of the cell phones, none of the cell towers were out. He laughed it off. He said, maybe I'm getting one up in heaven. I don't know. But this is me, I promise you. At the end of the day, I'd asked many dozens of guys, did you get any phone calls today? They said, no, still not getting any. It was about 24 hours later than anyone else received a phone call. His message to me that day was, don't lose heart, work hard, restore your community, be a leader, and keep everyone safe. He knew my job. Job at the time was the chief of training safety. He said, keep you guys safe, work hard, restore your community. Still, to this day, do not know how he was able to get through. The last story I'll share has to do with the time in which I was invited to assist my uncle with his rehabilitation following his thoracic surgery. Uncle Joe had lung cancer and had a lobectomy performed. When he was discharged from the hospital, I was privileged to spend 4 days with him. We got to spend a great deal of time talking and catching up on things we hadn't spoken about in years. Some discussions were favorite books, favorite movies, some politics, and some theological. I had shared with my uncle that one of my brother's favorite movies, Brother John and myself, and Brother Joseph, who is his namesake. I'll mention that my brother Joseph has a middle name of Michael. I always felt cheated, he told me many times, I wish they had actually given me the middle name, monsignor, which my uncle Joe kept secret for a long time. If you're not aware of the name, what the name's meaning is, the meaning is the messenger. He brought many messages. But I had shared with you that one of my favorite movies, one of my brother's favorite movies, was The Bronx Tale, starring Robert De Niro. And that the reason that this movie was our favorite was that the character played by Robert De Niro so closely resembled the character of my father. All yet he was a substitute bus driver and bartender. But his ways as a parent were very much parenting techniques of my father. Uncle Joe shared with me that his favorite movie was A Man for All Seasons. And he went on to say, and I recall, that I had seen this film in high school, and the subject was the life of St. Thomas More. Bishop Joe explained that the main character in the story put his love of the Father before all else. Not certain that at that time I fully understood how significant that summation of the plot was at that time. It planted a memory, and I believe it goes to Bishop Joe's epitaph. It wasn't until we were informed of his passing this past week that I decided to watch the film again. After viewing the film, it became apparent to me that the life of St. Thomas More had two important lessons that were very dear to my heart. And it struck me like a lightning bolt that his love of his family, his love of friends, and the love of his flock in both Houma and here in Jackson, its origins were as a wellspring, so to speak, from his love of the Father. That was first and was always first. Not more important, just first. So if I think that if you would want me to say anything today in one closing, that would be, I believe my uncle would say, remind everyone that I lived and died a loyal, faithful servant of my flocks, but God's first.
first like to thank Nara, Robert, and Randy, and Rachel, and Teresa, and Valerie, and Marty, and Joey, and John for allowing me to share Bishop with them. I've always felt welcome in your family, and always know that he loved you so much. And I'm going to share some things tonight. There's so many things that could be shared, some fun things and some beautiful things that I experienced. I wrote my master's thesis on women in the Gospel of Luke, an encounter with Christ. And if you read the Gospel of Luke, Jesus is always lifting up women. And even if they didn't even speak a word, like the widow of Nain, she never spoke, but he lifted her up. And their lives were forever changed. And I feel like when a man embraces your talents and lifts up your talents and supports you and mentors you like he did for me, that you want to be there for him and you want to make sure he's okay. And just as the women in the gospel wanted for Jesus. So it was an honor and a joy and a privilege. And I know Christine, you feel the same way. And I also want to thank Cheryl Coker tonight. That piece is from Cavalleria Rusticana, and Bishop would, when he retired, we shared an office, so he would come in most every morning humming that tune. So when you sang it so beautifully tonight, I did have to excuse myself and go wipe some tears away, because a lot of people don't know, but Bishop was an opera aficionado. And at the different performances, he didn't like to go by himself. He didn't like to be in a room with a lot of strangers. So I kind of became the person that would try to remember names for him. And so we would, and Bishop Howard would be there with us, and he'd say, oh, there's a beautiful quartet coming up in the final act. And it was Rigoletto, Bella, Familia, and also about the beautiful duet in the Pearl Fishers. He said that was really the only thing you needed to hear in the Pearl Fishers, so don't bother seeing the whole album. And then Tosca was, of course, the soprano's dream role. He was from New Orleans, but he really didn't like jazz, which we always found interesting. And everybody said, oh, are you going to have one of those second lines and things for his funeral? And I was like, no, because he would come back and haunt me forever. But he did, his stock in coolness went way up when Gene Luckett and I took him to a B.B. King concert. I told him, you know, you cannot get out of this life without hearing B.B. King play live. He came, and the normal security guards that were there to greet him But the last beautiful trip we had to Rome was in 2012 for the ad limina, and we added a trip to Sicily to the end of that. And he had never been able to go to Sicily, his ancestral home, and tying in with the Maronites, part of Bishop's family were Eastern Rite Catholics. They were the Albanians who immigrated to Sicily after they helped keep the Ottomans at bay from overrunning Europe. So the Pope rewarded these Albanians with five towns in Sicily. And most of the Sicilians in New Orleans came from that town, the Contessa Entellina. Sicilians ended up in New Orleans. So we traveled there, and I wrote ahead to the bishop, who was an eparch of the Italian, Albanian, Eastern Rite Catholics, and said, I have this bishop, he wants to come celebrate Mass in his grandparents' home church. And he actually had a cousin, in the letter to the bishop, he had a cousin who was a priest, Papas Mateo Chandra. And the bishop, who didn't speak any English, called on the telephone. And bishop didn't speak Italian, so I spoke a little from my time of studying in Rome. And Judy, the secretary, called downstairs, come upstairs, there's a bishop speaking Italian on the phone, we need help. So we figured it out with my minimal, which also works really well when your car breaks down on the side of the road in Sicily. You don't realize how much Italian you speak when that happens. But the bishop had been a student of Papas Mateo. He studied under him in seminary, and Papas taught music. And so I feel like he got his musical and his love for the church from his cousin. So it was a beautiful trip, and he was so energized. We got to go to his grandparents' hometown. What we thought was going to be a private mass just at the end of the day. When the doors opened, the church was packed with all these people from the town coming to see this bishop from America that was whose grandparents had come from that home. Got to meet Papas' nephew, and all these, we called them kissing cousins, because at the end of the Mass, the sacristy was just full of all these little old ladies coming in, oh, and he would just smile, and so it was just so life-giving to him. And I remember our last day there, the bishop had a nephew who spoke English, and he let him drive us all over the place. Took us to a restaurant by the seaside outside Palermo, and we ate, and they kept bringing food, and they kept bringing bottles of wine. And after the fourth bottle of wine between four people, we decided it was time to go, and we stopped by the seashore because our driver, whose name was Giuseppe, probably had not been around people that drank that much. He needed to clear his air, and we walked out to the seashore. And I had this wonderful photo of Bishop just staring out at the Mediterranean. And he said, I was thinking, this is probably the last view that my grandparents had before they sailed to America. So it was just so beautiful for him to connect on that. But what most people may not know is that Bishop's was in constant pain for the past 40 years. He had nerve pain in his legs that never subsided. And he bore that cross with such grace and elegance to continue to think you're gonna retire and then you get the phone call that you've got 10 more years of service and you're moving to Jackson, Mississippi. To get that call, but he bore that burden in spite of the pain. And going through all the different types of ways to relieve it, the neck surgery, the back surgery, then the compartment syndrome, where he had a clot in his leg, continued to bear that cross. And I felt like I was the cheerleader, trying to cheer him on and help him carry the cross. And that last day, which I would like to share some on that, if it's okay, just so you'll know what an experience it was. I felt like I went from helping him carry the cross to being at the foot of the cross, because the day certainly didn't start off the way we thought, the way it ended. It didn't start off that way. But it was a beautiful witness to, I'm in God's hands. God's going to take care of me. It's okay. And as the day went on in the emergency room, we could tell it was getting a little more dire and grave, the things they were trying. And as I reflect on it, the death was similar to what happens during a crucifixion, where you become so weak that you can't get the CO2 out, you can't get the air out, you can't get enough oxygen in. They had it, it was very comfortable, they had the right things going, but at one point they needed to drain some fluid. And what came into my mind was, and they shall look on him whom they have pierced, because they pierced to drain the fluid, and blood and water were extracted. And I thought,
grants to our souls. Give peace to Joseph forever. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Give us the stay of the river, and forgive us our Rizzuto.